We are glad to have with us today Dr. Mahesh Panchagnala. He is a professor in the Department of Applied Mechanics. He has a B.Tech in Mechanical Engineering from IIT Madras and a PhD from Purdue University in the United States, also in the area of Mechanical Engineering. He has been in the Department of Applied Mechanics here at IIT Madras. His areas of research include wetting and surface tension and liquid fuel atomization and combustion. He's also interacted a lot with industry and has a very good perspective of what industry is interested in, what academia is interested in, and so on. So with these words of introduction, we will get started in this discussion. So Mahesh, what are traditional areas of research in your department that incoming students are likely to have options to join?
Okay, thank you Pratap for having me. Our department is basically kind of structured into three groups. We have a group that works on fluid mechanics problems, another group that works on solid mechanics related problems, and a group that works on biomechanics and biomedical engineering related problems. And within these areas we have, these are kind of more granular, in other words, there is a lot of interdisciplinarity that we are very proud of in our department. We have faculty from 8 different undergraduate trainings, all the way from physicists to aerospace engineers, mechanical engineers, civil engineers are all represented in our department. So we bring a very, we are a melting pot of many different sciences and engineering, and that brings a very different flavor to our department's research. I would strongly encourage all the candidates to go find the faculty profiles on the web and study them. But classically, the department has focused on mechanics related problems, both in the fields of fluid and solid mechanics. And more recently, we've looked at, our faculty have started focusing on fluid structure interaction related problems, cell mechanics, which is a more biomechanics interfacing with solid mechanics problems, as well as interfacing electrical engineering into mechanical engineering.
Of course, I think in any set of research areas, even though it may be traditional, clearly there are boundaries to the research, and invariably the research is all about pushing those boundaries. So even though something may be classified as traditional research, you will have leading edge part of that research going on. But setting that aside, are there areas of research that you would consider more recent areas of research that people in your department have started pursuing, maybe let's say the last 5, 10 or 15 years, which is maybe different from what people have been pursuing over the longer time frame?
Okay, I think there's two technological advances that I think have enabled a lot of the newer areas of research worldwide. There's extremely fast computational mm-hmm. tools that have now become available. And there are extremely sophisticated analysis and visualization tools, electron microscopy, yes, etc., that have now become available. So we have faculty that do experiments and computations using these tools. For example, we have faculty studying tissue properties using nano indentation and atomic force microscopy. We have faculty doing very high-end computations on industry scale combustion problems, doing what is called direct numerical simulation of a particular kind of a flow. These are extremely challenging problems, and these have been enabled by, like I said, these tools that have now become available. And the insights that are being gained by the use of these tools will soon see the light of day in an industry scale deployment of a solution. I'll say these are still emerging research areas, but my vision is that in a few years we will actually see these tools solving industry problems. So these are the newer areas. In the traditional areas also, we must point out one difference in the way we at IIT pursue research in general, in our department as well. Using the traditionally developed research tools, there are a lot of India-specific problems that can be solved. Whether it is an organization like DRDO or an ISRO or any of the public sector undertakings or our rural problems, they do not require the extremely sophisticated tools, but they require an India level thinking and India scale thinking that require maybe traditional solutions, and we are not ready to discard those solutions because they are ready for our to solve our problems.
Okay, I think that's a very interesting insight into what's driving research these days and how it relates to what is required in our nation. You mentioned that, you know, in your department you have a wide range of different faculty. So presumably you also have a wide range of different students in terms of background.
Yes.
Who come into your department. So what sort of issues do they generally face when they come into their MS PhD program here? Are there some general issues that they face as they settle in? And if so, you know, how do you handle it? How do they handle it? And
sure. I think as a research, going from a classroom degree program to a research program is a big step up in a scholar's journey. In terms of the open-endedness that becomes available to them, that is in front of them. So until, as long as you're in a classroom environment, the problems are usually well defined. You know, like I say in my lectures, you know, given an equation involving four variables, given three, find the fourth. That's the classical problem solving.
Yeah, yeah.
Once you get into research, you will still have an equation involving four variables, but you're only given one variable. Now you have to figure out what works for the other three variables and justify your own assumptions. That, in a very loose definition, is kind of where you are getting into research territory. And then beginning to define your own area of research is a second challenge. So very often our faculty allow the scholar the freedom to choose their own area of research within the boundaries of what they are interested in and what they are equipped to work in. So this is a second challenge that the scholars usually face. And there are these are good challenges to have because this is where the scholars grow
positive challenges.
These are very positive challenges. And I think the way to approach these challenges is to be open-minded, is to not think of this as a challenge. Like you said, think of it as a positive challenge and grow into the solution to that challenge.
Okay.
And use the resources available, use your peer group. We have, like you said, we have a very diversified peer group in our department. The MS and PhD scholar students population in the department come from many different backgrounds. So talk to all of them and you will see a good perspective emerge of as to what the solution to these two questions are for your own training.
Okay, great. See, now when you look at research in an academic setting and then, you know, there is the industrial setting where, you know, people are focused on products that are supposed to come out, maybe are probably coming out right now or they are coming out in the immediate near future. So sometimes there is always this perception that maybe research is doing something which is not directly in line with what the industry is required, and maybe some of it may even be true. But taking that all that into account, are there specific areas of research that are there in your field that you know, industry is currently very interested in and are, you know, actively looking at?
Sure. I think being a publicly funded institution, we have a mandate to serve Indian industry in some way. I mean, it's part of our job description. And it's a part of the scholar's job description also when they come in to think of what India needs. And many of our faculty are involved with, like I said, DRDO and ISRO very actively, both by serving on several expert committees as well as in specific projects. So that's a direct way in which our faculty and students are working with the Indian industry. A more indirect way is where we are working on industry-related problems. And these serve as training grounds for scholars for the industry to absorb later on when they graduate. So many of our scholars find jobs in the Indian industry primarily when they graduate, whether it is a GE or whether it is a Boeing, whether it is a Mercedes-Benz. They have traditionally absorbed our research scholars graduating out of our programs. I think a large part of it is due to the fact that they've been trained on industry level, industry scale problems during their stint in the department.
Okay. When you look at, I'm sure you interact with students, you know, both belonging to your group, working with you, working with other colleagues of yours and so on. When you look at them going through their, you know, phases here of being a, you know, fresh incoming student, midway into their research, and they're getting close to graduation, different phases of their, you know, stay here, and then their early part as a professional. If you look at this range of, you know, time frame, how would you measure, you know, success in research in this kind of, you know, time frame when they start from nothing and then, you know, move towards something significant?
It's actually a phenomenal growth to watch, and I've had the chance to watch a few of my own students go through the process as well as my colleague students. When they come in, we usually find a big change is in their level of confidence in their own abilities. So, and I think that is with that's going to remain with them for the rest of their career, the confidence they gain while here at IIT and in the Department of Applied Mechanics. A second add-on is their own skill set that they gain while they are here at IIT. You know, IIT is by any definition a world-class institution in terms of the infrastructure we provide the students, in terms of the peer group, the faculty group. I think when they look at this big spread of a multi-course meal in front of them, the research scholars in their limited time they are here on campus end up sampling a lot of the different techniques and they add to their own skills. And at the end of the first few years, they are well equipped with the skills. The last few years, maybe 2 years that they spend on campus, I'm looking at a typical PhD student, is where the confidence grows leaps and bounds. And I can see this in their committee presentations as they go forward. Okay. And I think this is a very rewarding progress to watch as a faculty member. And I'm sure it is for them to reap the benefits of after they leave IIT.
Okay. You already mentioned something about, you know, industries that are looking at areas of research here with interest because it is of, you know, something related to what they are working on. In general, when you have, you know, when you look at master's students and PhD students, there is always this perception that they are specialists, and which is true, they become specialists in a specific area that they are working on. So when they graduate and look for positions, there is always this thing that this concept that, you know, they have to find something that is relevant to what they have become a specialist in. So where do you typically find MS PhD students graduating from your department, from Applied Mechanics? What sort of positions do they get, and in what sort of organizations do they get into?
It's a very good question. You know, placement at the PhD level is nothing like placement at the undergraduate level. So yes, we are dealing with people with specific skills, but IIT has set up mechanisms for industries needing specific skills to reach out to the candidates who are graduating with those skills. So I think by and large, a fraction of our candidates, of our scholars graduating, go into industry positions that build upon the skills that they already have acquired. Mm-hmm. A similar fraction, roughly about, let's say, a quarter of our of students go into positions where it may not be directly related to the skills they have acquired, but they have the background information necessary to grow into a position that the industry needs them to get into. But if you look at it, if you look at the problem from the other side, from the pull side, you know, as to where are the jobs for PhD students specifically, the biggest employer in India is the academia. We now have, you know, about 16 IITs plus more getting added next year. We have several NITs. Apart from these, we have very good state institutions, not to mention the multitudinous private institutions. They are all looking for good faculty members, and they are all reasonably well-paying positions. So a fraction of our faculty, of our research scholars, do go into these positions. Many of them are QIP candidates, so they are already faculty. They come gain the training here and go back to become better faculty members wherever they are. But I will say, I will encourage every graduating PhD student to look at an academic position, because if you want to, I've said this in other four as well, but if you want to be of service to the country, that is one position where India needs you. You look at the demographics and it doesn't lie. You know, the number of young men and women that are going to come into colleges in the next 10 to 15 years is humongous. No other country in the world has this kind of a challenge ahead of them. And the PhD scholars graduating from institutions like the IITs are the ones that have to solve the training problem there.
Okay. I think that's a very important point for young people to look at, because the promise of the nation is also in their hands to, you know, deliver. Let me know, we have spoken about various issues associated with the PhD process and as it applies to your department and areas that they work, students work in and so on. Let me ask you a very mundane question. I mean, during their stay here, one of the things, one of the aspects of, you know, graduate student life is how much they interact with, say, each other and how much they interact with their advisor. So in this context, I mean, in your experience and your view, How often should students be meeting their advisor or guide, and you know, how does that come out in play?
I think I will say initially you probably want to have a fairly high frequency of meetings, just so you are getting to know each other. And then typically I find that every advisor-student pair settles into their own comfort zone of, you know, how often they meet. Several of our faculty hold regular weekly meetings of the whole group, and they may hold more frequent meetings with individual students. We have a few faculty members who, after having gained a certain level of confidence in the scholar, may suggest that the scholar go about their own independent research and meet them even less frequently than weeks. So it depends completely on the advisor and the student. But I would look at that in the sense that this is something that you can define with your advisor. It's just the two of you. You sit down, you decide a level of interaction that is appropriate for you. And we also have a very thriving external program where the meetings are obviously less frequent but are just as productive in terms of research. So I will say one last thing as far as the advisor-student and student-student interactions go. You know, we are now at IIT a predominantly PG institution, and in the Department of Applied Mechanics is only a PG department. So we are all human beings, and very often we see conflicts arise, whether it is a student-student conflict or advisor-student conflict. Don't be unnerved by that. You know, there are professional mechanisms set up to handle conflicts at all levels, and I will say that we are also professional beings. I mean, I don't expect to be likable to every human being on this planet, and if there is a conflict, we have a mechanism to professionally resolve it, move on, and still be friends. I think at IIT, we take pride in that aspect, that we sometimes have issues with guides and students, but we have a professional mechanism that takes good care of that. Students graduate, they are very happy when they graduate, even after having gone through some issues like this. But I must also point out, this is a minuscule fraction of the 2,000 odd PhD students that we have on campus that have to encounter anything like this. So if you have these issues in mind, if you are apprehensive about trying to select a guide, I'll say don't be fearful, go in, because if something doesn't work out, there is a professional
lot of options available.
There are, just go in with a free mind, and I'm sure things will work out just well.
So to wind up, I just wanted to get your words on what are the words of advice that you would give to an aspiring student in applied mechanics?
I will say come in with an open mind. Be ready to do interdisciplinary work, because that's where the world lies today. Many of the problems cannot be put in vertical silos where I'm a mechanical engineer and all I learned in UG mechanical engineering is enough to solve this problem. So be ready to be more interdisciplinary. And I'll say come enjoy the ride. You know, to me, the third part is true with anybody anywhere in the world. Research is walk through an uncharted territory, uncharted open area. So you know you've succeeded when your peers outside IIT reward you and say, good, we like what you've done. Whether it is a publication, whether it is a pat on the back at the end of a conference presentation, we all look in the short term, that is a very clear success measure. And look for those measures. And mind you, your peer group is not your immediate 10 students around you, it is somewhere else in the world. That's why we publish in international journals. And I think look for those publications, you know, aspire to publish in the best journals, and I think you'll be just fine for the rest of your career.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dr. Mahesh. Okay. Thank you, Professor Mahesh, for joining us. It was a pleasure.